a man is braced to go outside on the coldest day on record in years. Snow is falling, and to his eyes, the winter wonderland is both mesmerizing and inviting. But the truth is, it's far from hospitable. He's not outside long when he coughs and then finds it difficult to breathe. Soon his teeth start chattering and his hands and arms are shaking. He decides it's time to go back inside. That's enough mesmerization for one day. Oh God, he's locked himself out. He reaches for the flask of whiskey in his pocket, thinking a hit of that'll warm him up a bit. What he doesn't know is that it's a really bad idea. After he downed his booze, he needs to urinate. The problem now is his hands are numb and his organ has shrunk so much he gets a flashback from when he was 2. Worse still, just minutes after he pees, he needs to go again. What we just described to you is a realistic scenario describing a lot of automatic things that the body does when someone's cold. There's a lot of science in there, so we're going to tell you exactly what's happening to this guy and what might happen if he stays outside much longer. So he coughed. Any of you people who live in places where the weather can get bitterly cold will know all about coughing on really bad days. The coughing is down to the cold air that can dry the airways and in turn cause the muscles to spasm. This can also narrow the airways, and that's why breathing can become labored. Even if you're super healthy, it can happen. But if you've got respiratory problems, the outcome will likely be worse. Okay, so then his teeth started chattering. What's going on there? That's a result of shivering. You see, when you're really cold, your body wants to bring your temperature up. To do that, a part of the brain called the hypothalamus sends a message to the rest of the body saying the thermostat needs more power. One thing that happens then is the muscles start to rapidly contract and relax. Some of those muscles are in the jaw, hence the teeth chattering. The guy then drank some whiskey from his flask, which did actually make him feel warmer. The problem is that hit of booze actually interrupted some of his body's natural warming processes. It made him feel warm for a while, but it was actually giving him a false sense of security. You see, alcohol is what's called a vasodilator. This means it can make a person's blood vessels expand, which can make someone feel flushed and bring on a feeling of warmness. All you drinkers out there will know this. But what you really need when you're cold is your blood vessels to constrict, not dilate, because in the long run, this will maintain your warmth better. Our guy might have got a temporary rush of blood to the head and a nice warm feeling come over him, but that's because his blood vessels have dilated. He's now going to cool down faster than if he had left the whiskey alone. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, there are often cases of people getting hypothermia after drinking alcohol in cold temperatures. If you're drunk, you might also have too much courage and think you can handle that long walk home in the snow. This has led to people passing out in the snow. Never let the booze trick you into thinking you're warm. That's some solid advice right there. He then needed to pee. This wasn't just because of the whiskey, it was also because in the cold, people generally pee more often. This is down to something called cold diuresis, which is a result of your body trying to direct more blood to those vital organs of yours. This is your body helping you out. The after effect of this is your kidneys getting more blood flow and them trying to filter out all that waste during urination, and that's why cold people pee more. This guy struggled to pee, with one reason being his hands were numb and he wasn't exactly deft with his digits. The reason people's extremities become numb when they're cold is that their brain wants more blood to get to those vital organs. Things were exacerbated for this guy because his John Thomas had shrunk. What was going on there? Well, yet again, it's down to less blood flow to certain parts of your body. And the penis is one of those parts that takes a hit for more important parts of the body. When cold, a man's member can actually shrink by about 50% in length and around 30% in width, which can make peeing with cold hands very hard indeed. As for the testicles, they move up closer to the trunk of the body so they can get more warmth. This doesn't bode well if you want to make love, which is a reason people in the past have talked about taking cold showers as a means to de-stimulate. The cold is certainly not great if you want to be aroused. So we have a guy who is already numb, he keeps needing to go to the bathroom, and he has crouched down to try and preserve heat. What could possibly happen to him next? The answer is he could get hypothermia, and at the extreme end of this, he might start taking off his clothes even though that's a very bad idea. This strange reaction is called paradoxical undressing. You already know that the blood vessels contract to preserve heat, but if someone was in bad shape, the muscles can become paralyzed, and this can make a person suddenly feel very warm as the blood vessels dilate. It usually means the end. What's even weirder is that many people who've reached this stage have later been found dead under a bed or inside a wardrobe. It was as if they'd gone into some kind of primitive state and tried to hibernate. The term for this is terminal burrowing behavior. In the past, this behavior has led police to think the person was a victim of a crime. That's likely the first thing that would come to mind if you found a naked person stuffed into some very tight space. Okay, now for some more incredible things your body does, and there's nothing you can do about it. You've likely all at one point in your life experienced having goosebumps, but the most perplexing case of goosebumps is when they happen when you're inspired by something, maybe a moving speech or an amazing song. First, we need to talk about something called the sympathetic nervous system. This usually sends messages to organs when a person is in a dangerous situation. When it activates, we have what's called a fight-or-flight response, which can be stuff like a rise in blood pressure and then your heart beating faster. That worked very well for humans in the past when they heard the roar of a saber-toothed tiger behind them. It can also make a person have goosebumps, but for various reasons. You see, a long time ago, us humans had a lot more body hair, what you could call a fur coat. It's thought we shed that coat and got naked around 1.2 million years ago. If one of those prehistoric beings was very cold, a natural reaction would be for his body hair to stand on end to trap more heat. These days, we aren't anywhere near as hirsute. So instead of our body hair setting up to attention, we only see goosebumps. Well, that's one reason. Another is if that animal in the wild came face to face with a prehistoric human, that human would have to look like it was mean and big. To look bigger, the hairs in its coat would stand on end. That all makes sense, but how come we have goosebumps when our favorite team scores a goal, or someone's merely thinking about a moment in their life that made them very happy? Why do people's arms look like a plucked chicken when they hear an amazing rendition of the Star-Spangled Banner? Well, even though these things are positive feelings, the brain still sends a message to the adrenal glands, so more of the hormone called adrenaline is released. The situation might not be stressful for the person, but all the same, the excitement can be so much that goosebumps happen. This influx of adrenaline might also lead someone to getting sweaty palms, feeling butterflies in their stomach, or feeling a shiver down their spine. Another effect is that the bowels loosen due to the adrenaline rush. How many of you have suddenly needed to pee right before you walked into a boxing ring or got up on stage? You can thank adrenaline for that. It's not clearly understood in terms of evolution why sweaty palms, aka Palmar hyperhidrosis, happens due to fear or excitement. One theory is that produced friction on the hands of our forebears, and that was good when fighting or flighting. As for butterflies in the stomach, this is related to blood being redirected from the gut so the arms and legs have more, and that's what you need when you're faced with a difficult task. This lack of blood affects muscles and the blood flow to the gut, and this slows down digestion. This can create a feeling of butterflies flying around in there. Then you have the shivering down the spine when you think about something, see something, or listen to the crescendo of a song. We're all wired differently in this respect, of course, and what gets off Harry won't work on Sally. Sometimes called a frisson or a skin orgasm, it's related to nerves that connect parts of the brain that process emotions. This can produce what's called an aesthetic response, which can release that wonderful chemical known as dopamine. Adrenaline is also the reason we blush at times, what Charles Darwin once called the most peculiar and most human of all expressions. This happens when adrenaline causes capillaries in the face to widen. Blushing sucks, so why did we evolve to do it? The likely reason is it communicates something to another person, whether you like it or not. What it communicates exactly is complex. You can blush when you're humbled, or embarrassed, or are given a wonderful compliment. Some people hate it and have a profound fear of turning red, something called erythrophobia. It might feel uncomfortable for all you chronic blushers, but you should know that it usually elicits a positive response from others. And now you have to ask yourself, how did those early humans react when they lost a person close to them? Did they cry as humans do nowadays? We can't say for sure, but scientists believe that they did cry because that was a way of communicating how sad they could get. The tears showed that the person had some empathy, and this in turn could create closer communities. One scientist said there's a possibility that those ancestors of ours that displayed a good old cry now and again were good survivors. Not weak, but strong. But why do some humans cry when, as kids, they found out that Bambi's mom had bit the dust? And why can some people cry over really trifling matters? Why do some people hardly ever cry at all? Well, like our ancestors, one of the reasons for crying is social cohesion and letting other people know you have some empathy. Then there's pain, and like some other animals, humans can cry when feeling significant physical pain. There's also the reason babies and politicians on Twitter do a lot of crying, and that's to get attention when they want something. After all, when you come into this world, you're pretty much useless, unlike some animals that can take care of themselves pretty quickly. Emotional tears, whether tears of joy or tears of sadness, are a more complex issue, and something that scientists haven't always seen eye to eye on. Then there's the theory we pointed out, that tears are there whether you're happy or sad, so others can make a connection with you. Sure, you might cry alone, but that's just a byproduct of what nature's programmed you to do. There's also another theory that says because sad tears have more protein, they stick better to cheeks, and that makes them more noticeable. Other tears, of course, trickle out of you when you have something in your eye or you're chopping onions. These are called reflex tears. You also have basal tears, which keep your eyes moist. Then you have psychic tears, the ones we're concentrating on now. Yet again, it's the brain's hypothalamus that's responsible for creating those tears when you're confronted by intense emotional situations, such as when an animated deer gets taken out by a hunter. Then there's also a rather more cynical side to crying. As babies, you realize that crying gets you whatever you want, so people might cry as adults to get what they want. Maybe you think you'd never do that, but the crying doesn't have to be a conscious thing. It can be involuntary, even though it's selfish. This crying might get you some approval from another person, but the act of crying itself can release the feel-good chemical endorphins. And that's one reason why some people feel a lot better after a good cry. This isn't always the case, though, because some studies have shown that people can feel a lot worse after crying. It all depends on the situation and whether someone felt relief or catharsis. As for people who cry a lot, they might be more of an empathetic crier, or they could even score high on a neuroticism scale, or they might have grown up in an environment where crying is normal and encouraged. A study in Germany found that people that hardly ever cried were more distant in terms of their feelings. They also might carry a lot of negative emotions around with them, such as bitterness or rage. As for laughter, the main reason we do that is also to let others know how we feel. When you meet someone and interact with them, laughter can be a way of letting that person know how you feel, whereas awkward laughter or no laughter at all might let someone gauge that you're not very impressed. Not only that, but when you laugh a lot, endorphins can be released, and this can reduce stress and create feelings of well-being. This is good for your immune system. Some evolutionary biologists think laughter goes back to how our ancestors groomed each other, since it can oil the cogs of a relationship. Others believe laughter evolved from noises we made as primates when we played. That's impulsive and uncontrolled laughter, but more controlled laughter might relate to getting your point across. As for what qualifies as funny, it's a very long story and not something we're getting into today. Let's instead look at some other strange things that happen to your body. You've all at some point in your life gotten out of the bathtub and looked at fingers and toes that looked like they belonged to a 110-year-old. The thing is, it only happens to those parts of your body. Why? It's a bit more complicated than water causing a biochemical reaction, and is actually down to the sympathetic nervous system, the part of your brain that makes your body do things without letting you in on it. We know this because scientists have cut certain nerves in the fingers and toes, and the wrinkling effect didn't happen. Your skin wouldn't wrinkle if your brain wasn't telling it to. One theory is that when wrinkled, we have really good grip. Imagine trying to pick something up with wet hands, something small and slippery. It would be hard, but perhaps not when you have your old person's grip. We don't know for sure if this is the main reason why we wrinkle in water, but studies have shown that wrinkled fingers could indeed help humans manipulate certain objects. During tests, people with wrinkled fingers were asked to move marbles from one place to another. Some marbles were dry and others were wet. With the dry marbles, there wasn't any difference. But humans with wrinkled fingers were better at moving wet marbles than humans with normal fingers. That was just one study, though. A later study found there was no difference. Still, some scientists believe our wrinkling function evolved as a way to manipulate things and possibly climb trees. It might not help us modern humans grip much better, but it could have been a lifesaver to our long-lost relatives. Now you need to watch what would happen to your body if you lived in the ocean. Or have a look at this. I did 30 push-ups for 30 days, and this is what happened. Funny challenge.